Hi, Trina.
Hi, good morning, Liz.
You're co-head of Goldman Sachs' China Equity Research, and your team has recently created an aggregated demand tracker that tracks consumer and industrial demand across China from the ground up. What's the thinking behind this new product?
Yes, Liz. So there are a couple of reasons we put together this tracker. So first of all, typically China's official stats come 1 to 2 months late to start with, which is not ideal. But on the other hand, the COVID-19 disruption, however, has led to some very unusual changes on the other hand, in terms of both pace of the changes and the magnitude of changes we see on the ground. And we think our clients and also our own research would need much higher frequency real-time activity indicators for this period of recovery. The other reason is really when we try to look at all the sectors and the data, the change also made us realize how much interdependence these sectors have now become, probably in this type of condition more than ever. So having something that covers from upstream to midstream to downstream really helps us and hopefully our client to read cross and also hopefully anticipate the changes.
And so how's the tracker put together?
So we start with asking each sector analyst to think about a couple of indicators in their respective sectors that can represent the recent industry trend and can be practically updated, hopefully on a weekly basis, if possible. At the end, we ended with about 58 data inputs from analysts in our China team. So with a quarter of the data actually coming from upstream, that is material, energies, a quarter coming from midstream production activities and industrial activities, and also half of them coming from consumer-related downstream sectors, the very end demand.
So if you break out demand from the more upstream components, like commodities and energy, and the more downstream measures that reflect the consumer, what sectors are you seeing the most recovery, and which ones have still a long way to go?
I would say the sector we're seeing probably the most recovery are consumer staples and the construction. So consumer staples are food-related demand, essential demand that has little disruptions and recovered very quickly after the disruption in February in China. Construction, it was quite depressed back in February, but because of government policy push, so it's now back to the pre-virus level, even a little bit higher than the pre-virus level. So I would say the sector that is relatively lagged is actually consumer discretionary, and now sitting at on average about 64% of the normal level based on our most recent update around the end of April. But the range is very wide. So we have auto, major restaurants, sportswear is now doing quite well, sitting at 70 to 90% of the normal level already. We have a very bumpy appliance sales that depends on which week has promotions. So it could swing between 60 to 100%, depends on the week. Air travel, tourism, as you can imagine, these are still very weak. No one is going to the box office. And now, as of now, no one is going to casino, partly it's also because of government restrictions. So these are kind of the differences within the consumer discretionary. But having said that, overall, we're still seeing a couple percent improvement each week sequentially on this probably the most important sector.
You've mentioned a number of inputs that the tracker uses, but what are some of the more unusual inputs that you're looking at to get a read on the economy?
We have very different types of data inputs. For example, so we like dealership data, for example, on appliance and auto sales, which tends to be leading the production numbers. There are cases we use sample companies for aggregate industry sales trend. Being a cyclical analyst myself, so I like to choose mid players, not the top ones, whose business tends to be more sensitive to changes of market condition, and they tend to be the first one telling you things has changed on the ground. There are also cases we could actually make use of alternative data sources. For example, we have very good quality data for chemicals goes into consumer products, the clothing goes to furniture and auto production. So these can be cross-checked with our direct consumer sales data if there's availability, which give us a more balanced picture. So we really have to leverage all the different resources to actually get to the aggregated results.
You put out the third edition of the tracker last week. What did the aggregated demand show about the trajectory of China's economic recovery?
Yes, if we really look at the most recent update, the average aggregate demand level averaged to about 81% as of April 24th. So that's our last data points updated. And this is versus the bottom in February, which is only around 50%. But back in January, we were at about 90%. So the pace of the recovery was quite rapid from February to March in the first months of activity resumption, but now becomes a bit more modest in the past 1 month. But clearly activity improvement are taking place in China. But we have to recognize that overall activity is still about 10-20% below the normal level based on the current read. So we hope this tracker can continue to provide indication for the path forward.
You personally have a lot of experience following basic materials sectors like coal and cement and steel, which have been heavily influenced by China's infrastructure spending. How do you expect a renewed focus on infrastructure to affect demand in those areas?
We are clearly seeing the benefit in demand, for example, steel, cement, as we speak, which is consistent, as you can see, with the strong construction activity we have seen from the tracker. However, we should mention the new infrastructure. So these are not the traditional roads and the bridges. What they are is 5G stations, artificial intelligence, industrial IoT, ultra high voltage transmission, intercity, metros, et cetera. So today they account for less than 10% of China's total infrastructure investment, but they are expected to grow over 20% this year and 15% for 2021. And very likely that this type of double digit growth will continue in many years to come. What it represents is actually not only it helps to offset economic slowdown in the near term, but it's also, in our opinion, that part of China's structural transition. And this transition has been taking place, but accelerated now seemingly on the back of this virus disruption. If executed well, it will bring actually productivity gain for the economy in China in the future.
Thanks, Trina.
Well, thank you, Liz. Thank you for having me.